every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Hey, it's Rhonda Sciortino, and this is Find Your Purpose Now. I'm so excited to talk to you about just some of the ways that you can explore your identity, which is really the basis of your purpose. You can really ask yourself some questions to dig deeper, maybe than you ever have before, about who you really are, who you were really meant to be. And I say it that way because, you know, a lot of us conform to the family we're raised in. We conform to fit in. We conform to be like somebody that we admire. We learn when we're little kids what's going to get us in trouble, what's going to earn us, you know, points. And so we wind up conforming, and a lot of times we don't even know that we've conformed. And as we get older in different seasons of our lives, we can do that with really good friends. We can do that with coaches and teachers and mentors, and with our, you know, the people that we decide we want to do life with. We can wind up kind of masking our true personality. We can dial down our authenticity when it's not appreciated, or when a full dose of our personality would just be too much in the situation. And so you do that enough, and you can actually lose track of who you really are and what you're really all about. Okay, so I wrote down some questions that I think are relevant and pertinent to this exploration. And let me just tell you, it's worth doing because, and you could do it, maybe you do it once a year. You could do it every 5 years or whatever, but you know, we grow, we change. So who you were when you were 5 years old is different from who you were at 15, right? And at 25 and 35 and 45, it just think about setting aside the things that you think you know and having a clean slate, and really think about your answers before you just move on to the next one because you already know what this. No, really think about how you feel now, today, at this present level of growth and maturity. You know a lot of things now that you didn't know 5 years ago or 10 years ago. Okay, so, all right, so here we go. Number one, what do you like best about your personality? Really think about this. Don't just say, oh, I have a great sense of humor, and move on to number two. Really think about personality traits. And you may have heard me say this before. Go online and do a quick Google search of personality traits. You know, some people, one of my good friends just uses that chat GPT every single day for everything. Okay, if you know, if that's you, ask Mr. Chat GPT what the 100 most common personality traits are, or whatever, and see what see what it comes up with. But if you will do a search and really go beyond the I'm an introvert, I'm an extrovert, I'm caring, I'm friendly, the basic things, go beyond that and really explore some of the personality traits that maybe you haven't even thought of or you haven't thought of in a while, you might discover new aspects of yourself. And it's worth doing because here's the thing. When we are naturally built a certain way, as an extrovert, for example, I'll just use that as an example. We tend to think it's not that big of a deal because everybody's like that. Well, everybody's not like that. And so the things that you learn about yourself are important. Learn more about that personality trait and why that's good and why that's important. The things that some people think make you quirky or annoying or whatever might be the very thing that's the key to your purpose. Okay. All right. Number two, what comes easily to you that you do well? These are like natural skills. You didn't learn it in school. You just know how to do it. I'll give you an example of something that I never would have thought of until a person close to me had this. And I thought, oh my gosh, this is huge. This is so important. The ability to anticipate the needs of others. You might not think that's that big of a deal, but for example, the person who brought this up to me is a retired nurse. And she was talking about how, you know, when somebody comes into the emergency room and they're not conscious or they're barely conscious, they can't tell you what's wrong. You have to be able to anticipate their needs, anticipate what might be wrong, anticipate what the doctor is going to ask for. That idea of thinking one step ahead or two steps ahead of what might be needed in a situation is huge. Not just for being a nurse, for being a parent, for being an employee, for being an employer. If we can anticipate those things that might happen, are likely to happen, the things we don't want to have happen, in that case, for example, that's risk management. If you think about, okay, I don't want to have a car accident. Let's say it's winter. It's a very rainy or snowy winter. I don't want to have a car accident. So what can I do? Check the brakes on the car. Check the tires. Check the windshield wipers. Make sure all of those things are in good working order. You see, it's an anticipatory. And if you can anticipate things that could go wrong, you can take steps that will make it so they don't go wrong or they're less likely to go wrong. Okay. There are many, many more things, obviously. There are people who just know how to do accounting, for example. You know, they didn't go to school to be an accountant. They just are naturally good with numbers. There are people who can look at, things that need to go into a box and say, that's not going to fit. And then there's the rest of us who are going to, you know, spend an hour trying to pack the box and find out at the end that everything's not going to fit. So there are these things that you know how to do. You just know. You don't know how you know. You just know. Okay. Think about those things, because those are a huge clue to your purpose. What do you know now that the average person doesn't know? There are things that you know that you can see. Like you hear about something on the news, you hear about a situation, and you just want to shake your head. Like, really? How did this happen? How did this person let this happen? There are things that you know, and you know that you know that you know, because you've lived through it, you've survived it, you've seen it with your own eyes, that the average person doesn't know. That can be a clue to what you're made to do. What bugs you? I like to say what grieves your heart. Like, for me, it's child abuse, child trafficking. I can't stand it. I'm called to do something about it. I can't change the world. I can't make people suddenly not be abusive. But what I can do, for me anyway, everybody, the call on everybody's life is different. Your vocation that you're called to is different from everybody else. But for my example, when I say, okay, the idea of child trafficking is so heinous to me, I can't stand it, what can I do? So I really thought about that. And I decided that it's better to prevent a child from being trafficked, for me, in my mind, than waiting until after it already happened and then trying to rescue somebody. So I launched a prevent child trafficking program in Las Vegas, because Las Vegas is a worldwide hub for child trafficking. And so the idea is to create this model that can be replicated in communities, neighborhoods all over the United States. So think about what bugs you, what grieves your heart, what would you like to see changed in the world? So can you change the world? Yeah, probably not. But you might be able to do something in your home, in your family, in your neighborhood, in your community, in your workplace, at your church. You might be able to do something. And even if you think it's really small and it doesn't matter, yes, it does. Yes, it does. Whatever grieves your heart is probably there for a reason. It's probably there for you to do something about. And whatever piece, little piece of the work that you can do, do it. That one thing, you know, volunteering to work with a nonprofit that, you know, if your thing is preventing animal cruelty, for example, I mean, whatever your thing is that bugs you, volunteering with an organization that's addressing that, you know, posting something on social media to raise awareness about the problem, whatever you can do, do it. Okay. Number five, what are you interested in? What kinds of things pique your interest? That may mean that there's a career in that field for you. Maybe it's something that you do as a hobby or as a volunteer, something on the side. Whatever it is, explore it. Don't just dismiss it like, well, I could never do that. I don't have the right education, or I'm not in the right location to be able to do that. Don't dismiss it. Really think about it. And if you're really interested in it, think about ways that you could be involved on some level. Maybe it could be a career. Maybe there's a piece of it that you could carve out for yourself and make a life doing that, the thing that you're really fascinated in. So, number six, what opinions and judgments influence your thoughts, attitudes, and actions? Wow, think about that. What opinions and judgments influence you? Your thoughts, let me add your words, the things that you say, your attitudes, and then all of that, of course, influences your actions. So what are those things? I would say, not only give those some thought, but maybe break it down and question some of those things. An example might be, this is kind of a controversial thing, but I'm going to say it. I don't normally get into, controversial stuff, but, for example, if you have an opinion about abortion or racism, something that's a really hot button issue and can be incendiary, in conversation and whatnot, ask yourself, or try to think back, where did this opinion come from? Why do I feel the way I do about this particular issue? Drill down. Most of the things that are emotionally charged are so for a reason. What emotions are triggered in you when you think about controversial kinds of things? About how those opinions and judgments are formed. And here's the reason that I'm saying that. I think it's important because when we're growing up, we tend to adopt certain filters, lenses, if you will, through which we see the world. And unless there's a point in time where we stop and we question it, we can carry those things into our adult lives. In some cases, an opinion that happened to be the opinion of, our grandfather, that we just kind of, we absorbed it, we didn't question it, we just carry it, that can be the reason why you don't get included or invited or hired. These are the kinds of things that people won't tell you most time. People don't want to start an argument. They don't want to, have conflict. For example, in a situation where you're interviewing for a job, you're very interested in a job, and the person interviewing you picks up on like a tinge of something that they feel like is racist or that they feel like could be something that's not quite right. They're not going to tell you. They're just not going to hire you or promote you. So it makes sense for us as adults to really go back and look at those things. What are our strong feelings, opinions, judgments? Where did they come from? Why do we feel that way? And you might, you know, you think it all the way through based on what you know now, who you are now, and you may find that you feel the exact same way. Great. You may also find that you actually feel differently. My example of that is about the issue of abortion. When I was young, growing up without a mother and a father, they had both left, I had a terrible life. I was being abused. We lived in a very scary place. We lived in poverty, so there wasn't a lot of food. And in my little girl mind, with not a lot of maturity and logic, I really felt like it would have been better if I had never been born. I wasn't wanted. So what I knew to be true, and the facts supported this, was that I was not wanted and I was not loved. And I thought I would never be loved. I would never be wanted. Why was I even born? Therefore, when I heard about abortion, I thought, my mother should have had an abortion. I should not have been born. I wasn't supposed to be born. I'm taking up space on earth. I'm using up air that's, you know, meant for someone more worthy than I. I really felt that way. And I felt strongly that women should be allowed to have abortions and get rid of babies that they didn't want and didn't love. And because I was one. So now, as an adult, having lived, you know, a lot of years on planet Earth, I feel completely opposite of that. It's a 360 because it's not a 360, it's a 180, because I feel like my mother gave me the greatest gift. She gave me life before she left. She gave me an opportunity to make of this life what I could. And I feel like I got the best DNA from her and her ancestors, and the best DNA from my biological father and his ancestors. And I have had a great life. And so now I feel like what a horrible thing to take the opportunity for a good life away from a helpless, the most vulnerable human being, a child in the womb. So wherever you happen to land on that, I hope you don't shut me down because of the way I feel, but this is just the way I feel. God gives everybody their free will. And so I figure I will too. I'm using this example, though, just as an example of an opinion or a judgment that I felt strongly pro-choice when I was very young. I now feel very strongly pro-life. And so I really and truly can see both sides. I've passionately debated both sides. Everybody who knows me knows my opinion. Every opinion is passionate. And so the point is, we can change. We can learn, we can grow, we can evolve with our opinions and judgments. But it's important to know what yours are, because all of that goes to your perspective and your context and your worldview, the lens through which you see the world. And that goes to your purpose. I've been a child advocate for decades. And what kind of a child advocate would I be if I didn't care about children from the jump, right? And so for me, evaluating that strongly held opinion was important. It helped me to define who I am and why I feel the way I feel. And, you know, the opinions and judgments that I have. And I hope that this is helpful for you too, to understand these things about yourself. Now, I have many, many more questions, but I've run out of time today. So I hope that you'll come back next week and we'll talk about, oh gosh, the things that you heard as a child, the things you overheard, compliments that you received, criticisms that you've received, all these different things that might in and of themselves seem insignificant, but they're all part of it. Every one of these questions is a puzzle piece that you can put together. And I'm telling you, when you do this, when you really do this work, the picture of your purpose begins to just get clear and just come up off the page at you. And when you can get a clear vision in your mind of who you are and what you do well and all of those kinds of things, it will become clear what you should be doing from this point forward for the next assignment in your life that is the stepping stone to the fulfillment to your purpose. I'm here for you. I'm with you. I want to hear from you about your journey and what you learn about who you are and what you should be doing. And when you start to do it and you start to, you know, have this amazing life that's meaningful and fulfilling, I'm telling you, I want to hear about it because there's nothing better. Seriously, your life just becomes so much more meaningful and rich and fulfilling. And the right people for you show up in your life. Because the people who are in that world, they're there. They're doing it. When you step into what you were made to do, you will find yourself with your people. That's what happened with me when I decided, okay, well, I'm protecting and defending the good people and organizations that take care of abused kids. I didn't see myself at first as a child advocate. I saw myself as an insurance broker who specialized in managing the risk of child welfare organizations. But when I started to really own who I am, a survivor of abandonment, abuse, neglect, poverty, you know, all these different things, childhood trauma. When I started to see myself that way, and then I began to see myself as a successful survivor of all those things, and how all of that prepared me and equipped me and qualified me to manage risk for child welfare organizations and professionals, I started to see, I get clarity on the deeper, more meaningful picture that it wasn't about transactional insurance at all. It was about advocating on behalf of children who have no voice. They have no vote, that they're a constituency, if you will, that's invisible, you know, in terms of politics and so on. And so becoming a child advocate and representing the estimated 12 million former foster kids in the United States, being a voice changed me and changed my life and gave me and all of that horrific, painful beginning a meaning. And when we can find meaning for the hard things that we've been through, for the painful things that we're going through, it makes all the difference in the world. I mean, if everybody could find the meaning of their life, their authentic identity, and plug in and live their purpose in life, we would have a lot less depression. We would have a lot less suicide. We'd have a lot less substance abuse disorder because we wouldn't be medicating our pain. We would be a lot happier because we would be in relationships with like-minded people who care about the same kinds of things that we care about. I mean, I don't really have the words, and I have a pretty robust vocabulary, but I don't really have the words to adequately explain the difference this makes. When I saw myself as a child advocate, and I really leaned in to that role, and I started going to Washington, D.C., and I started meeting with Congress people and staffers and whatnot, and speaking on behalf of survivors of child abuse. I said 12 million former foster kids, but there's the number of survivors of child abuse who are walking around in the United States today is many more times that number. It's estimated at least three times that number, and I would guess to say it's more than that. So we're talking about, you know, if 6 out of 10 little girls are abused before they're 10 years old, and I think 4 out of 10 little boys, excuse me, and these numbers might be different now, but think about it. Survivors of childhood abuse are everywhere. When I started to see myself as an advocate, as a voice for all those people, and put myself in those places to be heard, I met some of the most amazing people. I really fully believe that when you find your place and you lean in, you are going to meet your people. And your life is going to change in a most amazing way. All right, I'll see you next week.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.